got her,
She got her what?
Her gift. little bracelet action.
Yeah. Okay, obscure blank song.
We never will part.
Over the
voice.
Maybe.
Call me fat.
If Greg is married, he's gonna take a woman's name.
What is
right?
Called Operation
and the Wisdom name.
Dan, here you go.
Ah, look at that.
I love it.
Awesome.
Time for a cleansing breath. Whew. You made it. You know, Amy, my favorite thing to do at a wedding is to watch the groom when that door opens. And Dan went from a nervous face to us, to a smile, to his teeth showing. I think he was pleased. Well, this is a great moment. And I just want you to take a second to soak it in. To just take it in, to enjoy this moment. You are in the presence of God, and He loves you with an everlasting love. And you are in the presence of friends and family that love you so much. You know, last night at the dinner, seeing how much they loved you and cared for you and were willing to show us videos to learn about you and great things like that. It's just wonderful. So just take this moment in. We don't want to rush it. And we want to take this into our heart and enjoy this moment. Because we've gathered together today to join this woman and to join this man in the bonds of holy matrimony. Who gives this woman to this man?
I do.
Well, as we gather before God and these witnesses to join you in marriage, we have to enter into this moment acknowledging the seriousness of it. Marriage is a sacred, sacred moment. And it's an institution that we enter into seriously and reverently and soberly. We don't want to rush into this, and I know that you haven't, because marriage is a picture of God's love. And so for this reason, I've got to charge you before God and these witnesses that the vows you are taking today are binding. They are meant to be taken as long as you both shall live. So with that in mind, Dan, do you take Amy to be your wedded wife, to live together after God's ordinances in the holy estate of matrimony? Will you love her and comfort her, honor her and keep her in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keeping only Amy so long as you both shall live? If you do, respond by saying, I do.
I do.
And Amy, do you take Dan to be your wedded husband, to live together after God's ordinances in the holy estate of matrimony? Will you love him and comfort him and honor him and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keeping only Dan as long as you both shall live? If you do, respond by saying, I do.
I do.
Let's pray together. Father, we now come before you at this moment in time, bringing Dan and Amy and their desire to commit themselves to each other. So, Father, I pray that you would bless this time, that you would bless the two of them, that you would bless this ceremony today, and that not only would you be glorified, but that we would absolutely love you and love others so much more as a result of being here today. So, Father, I commit this time and this ceremony to you for your kingdom and for your glory. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We are now going to sing a congregational song. Some of you may know the words. If you don't know the words, I would encourage you to just listen to them. They're beautiful. But if you know them, please feel free to sing out.
This cornerstone, this solid ground.
in the power of Christ, I'll stand.
The first scripture reading is taken from the book of Proverbs, chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. My son, do not forget my teaching, but keep my commandments in your heart, for they will prolong your life many years and bring you peace and prosperity. Let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on a tablet of your heart. Then you will win favor and good name in the sight of God and man. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all of your ways, submit to him, and he will make your path straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and shun evil. This will bring health to your body and nourishment to your bones. Honor the Lord with all of your wealth, with the first fruit of all of your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine. My son, do not despise the Lord's discipline, and do not resent his rebuke, because the Lord disciplines those he loves, like a father disciplines the son he delights in.
Second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have the faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor, and give over my body to hardship, that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind. Love does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always preserves. Love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Word of the Lord.
Bye.
A reading from the first letter of John. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is of God. Everyone who loves is begotten of God and has knowledge of God. The man without love has known nothing of God, for God is love. God's love was revealed in our midst in this way. He sent his only Son to the world that we might have life through him. Love then consists in this, not that we have loved God, but that he has loved us, and has sent his Son as an offering for our sins. Beloved, if God has loved us so, we must have the same love for one another. No one has ever seen God, yet if we love one another, God dwells in us, and his love is brought to perfection in us. The word of the Lord.
Dan and Amy, something is happening today that you guys are probably unaware of. You're looking at me surprised. You guys are actually starting something. Now, this is going to sound a little cheesy, but you guys are starting something today that you've never had the power to start before. You are actually starting an international holiday. What do I mean by that? See, from this point forward, this time every year, it's going to be your anniversary. And everywhere you go in the world, when they find out it's your anniversary, they're going to say, happy anniversary. Waiters are going to bring you food. People are going to throw you parties. Lord willing, you'll hit milestone anniversaries, and family and friends will gather together and buy you presents and tell you how much they love you and say, happy anniversary. This day will be marked off forever as a unique day. And in fact, this day marks off forever in a powerful way, because what is happening here today is going to impact every decision, every part of your life forever. It's a powerful day that you'll be celebrating. Now, some people ask, why in the world would you go through all this trouble? Why get married? What's the point of it? Well, when you realize, and I know you know this, when you realize marriage is not really just an emotional thing. It's not like those Hallmark movies, you know, where you have the two people and you know at the end they're going to get together and the whole movie is just how they do it. And it all gets together and you get the tear in your eye at the end of it because they got together, and even though you knew it was coming. But that's really not marriage. That's a great feeling. Those are great emotions. But marriage is so much deeper than that, because really marriage is something that God created. We didn't come up with this idea. When God created man and woman, he put them together and he said, now I'm putting you together for a reason, to be a picture of my love. I want you two to experience me. And the love that I have, and the love I have for my creation, the love that exists within the Trinity, that love I want you two to experience so that the world can look at you and see God's love. So a child can come and say, well, what does it mean that God loves us? We can say, look at Dan and Amy. That's the picture. So I was thinking, one of the things we should do in terms of the ceremony before you give your vows is just to take a moment and be reminded of God's love. Because we hear that God loves you, God is love, but sometimes we have to be reminded of what that really means so that you can be reminded of what your vows mean, because you're going to be saying some vows in a moment, and the vows that you'll be saying are connected to the love of God. They're meant to actually reflect his love for us. And I was thinking about you these past few weeks, and my thought came to Isaiah chapter 43. It's a wonderful passage. The people there were facing huge trials, huge problems. The world was collapsing on them economically. Armies were coming in to conquer them. Things were bad. Everything was falling apart morally, politically, economically. And God sends a message through Isaiah to the people, and he wants them to know, hey, I love you. As you go through this, be reminded of my love. And God says four things to them. Here are the four things. And these four things that he says to them represent what true love is. Not just that emotional love, but what true love is. And this is what your vows that you're about to take are really signifying, is this true love of God. Listen to this. The first thing that we learn about this true love of God is that it's a love of a relationship. Now, these people are going through a trial, and he says to them, do not be afraid, for I have ransomed you. I've called you by name. and you are mine. What he was saying is, listen, I know you. I didn't just go out there and just create a bunch of religious things that you're supposed to do. I have called you by name because I have a relationship with you. And I love you. I know you. I know you inside and out. And you think about it, the vow that you are going to say in a few moments, you're going to say, Dan, you're going to say, I take you, Amy. And Amy, you're going to say, I take you, Dan. And I want to know you. And you're going to get to know each other, all of the good and the bad and the ugly. You're going to learn it all. And that's the joy. The reality of true love says, listen, I want to be in a relationship with you. God says, as you're facing this trial, I love you. And I know you. You guys, your love is about this intimacy of relationship where you become one. But there's something else about this love, pretty amazing. It moves even beyond relationship to recognizing that this true love is a love of protection. Now, they're facing these huge trials, and listen to what God says. He says, when you go through the deep waters, and you go through the great troubles, and you go through the rivers of difficulties, realize this, I will be with you. You will not drown. When you go through the fires of oppression, he says, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you. And then he says, for I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. He's telling them when they're facing that trouble, I'm your protector. I'm going to protect you. And the great thing about love, true love, is that you guys get to protect each other, care for each other. You're going to reflect that love of God. It says that you're going to go through it, but I'm going to be on top of you, on the side of you, around you. And as you go through life, you're never going alone. That's the same thing for you guys. You will never, ever go through life alone. You will have each other. And you get the joy of protecting each other's honor, protecting each other's integrity, being with each other in such a way to say, this is my wife, and I'm going to hold her high when I'm in public. And this is my husband, and I'm going to hold him high when I'm in public. Why? Because I love him. And true love protects. True love protects. God, he protected his children in the midst of this fire. You guys get to reflect that in your marriage. But there's something else. True love also sacrifices. He says this. He says, others died that you might live. And your lives are precious to me because you're precious to me. That's what he says. Sacrifice. And we know God is willing to go to any sacrifice to show us his love. Isn't that right? We just sung of Christ. He came to take the punishment we deserve so that God could pour out all his love on us. He's willing to put that sacrifice out there to bring us into relationship with him. And you get the joy of sacrificing for each other. See, that's what true love is. True love sacrifices. But there's one more thing, he says. True love is also a choice. He says, you are honored because I love you. You realize this. God didn't say to those people, well, you don't earn my love right now. You got to earn it. You got to build up enough credit, and then I'll choose to love you. He says, no. Listen, even while we were sinners, Christ died for us. He loves us. He loves us with an everlasting love, and he has chosen to love us. And that's what you're doing today. You're going to stand here in just a minute and give your vows. And you know what you're saying? I'm choosing to be with you. I'm choosing to be with you for the rest of my life. Isn't that incredible? I like that smile, Amy. That's a good smile. If you could see your smile. You're choosing to be there because you are reflecting the love of God. So here's what we're talking about. God, when he wanted to reveal his love, he says, it's a love of relationship. I know you. It's a love of protection. I'm going to be with you. It's a love of sacrifice. I'm willing to trade. I'm willing to take it to save you. And it's a love of choice. I'm honoring you because I love you. It's love. And that's what you guys get to put on display here today. It's that love. And for the rest of your life, as you learn how to do these things, and it's a journey, you won't do it perfectly, but as you learn how to do it, and each step of the way you'll learn a little bit more, it's going to make you a better worshiper of God, and it also will share it with everybody how awesome God is. And you know what I'm most excited about today? Is that I know you guys believe this. And I know this is in your heart. And I believe God's going to bless you for that. Let's pray together. God, you are so awesome. Your love for us is so deep. You know us by name. You're willing to go through the difficulties of this world. You're willing to sacrifice that we might live. And you do it because you've chosen to love us. What a great thing. Lord, I pray for Dan and I pray for Amy. I pray, God, that right now that they would truly, truly in their hearts, through the power of your Spirit, just have that love awakened in them even more. As they get to know each other, may that be a joy. As they get opportunities to protect and uphold each other, may that be a joy. As they get opportunity to sacrifice and to choose to act on this love, may that deepen their love for you, their love for each other. But Lord, not only that, I pray that it would be an encouragement to everyone who sees them, that they might reflect your great love to this world. I thank you for them, Lord. We pray that you would bless them richly. In Christ's most magnificent name I pray. Amen. Thoughts in mind that I now ask you to make your vows before God. This is a very important moment, for it's in this moment that you commit yourself to each other and to God. Would you pass your flowers off and turn and face each other? Take hands. Dan, would you repeat after me? I, Dan, take you, Amy.
I, Dan, take you, Amy.
To be my wedded wife.
To be my wedded wife.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or worse.
For better or worse.
For richer or poorer.
For richer or poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
According to God's holy ordinance.
According to God's holy ordinance.
Amy, would you repeat after me? I, Amy, take you, Dan.
I, Amy, take you, Dan.
To be my wedded husband.
To be my wedded husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or worse.
For better or worse.
For richer or poorer.
For richer or poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
According to God's holy ordinance.
According to God's holy ordinance.
Now it's customary at a wedding for there to be gifts given, and the gifts that we give is the gift of the ring. And the ring symbolizes a couple of things. First, that love, right? The ring has no beginning and end, and that ring goes on and just reminds us of God's everlasting love, and it's a pure love, hence the gold. But the ring is also a symbol of the covenant that you just made. And every time you look at that ring, every time you touch it, every time you spin it around on your finger, every time you take it off and put it on, it's to remind you of this great love that you share between the two of you. So do we have the rings? Dan, would you take Amy's ring here? Would you place it on her left finger? And repeat after me. I give you this ring.
I give you this ring.
As a symbol of my vow.
As a symbol of my vow.
And with all that I am.
And with all that I am.
And all that I have.
And all that I have.
I honor you.
I honor you.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
And the Son.
And the Son.
And the Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Amy, would you take this ring? Put Dan's left hand there. Repeat after me. I give you this ring.
I give you this ring.
As a symbol of my vow.
As a symbol of my vow.
And with all that I am.
And with all that I am.
And all that I have.
And all that I have.
I honor you.
I honor you.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
And the Son.
And the Son.
And the Holy Spirit.
And the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
I pray you be our eyes and watch us where we go and help us to be wise in times when we don't know. Let this be our prayer. When we lose our way, lead us to a place, guide us with your grace, to a place where we'll be safe. I pray we'll find your light. Hold it in our hearts. When stars go out each night, remind us where you are. Let this be our prayer. When shadows fill our day, lead us to a place, guide us with your grace, give us faith so we'll be saved. Sonom yo mondo, senza più violenza, un mondo di giustizia, di speranza. Oh no, no, diala, maro so venitino, simbolo di pace, di fraternità. We ask that life be kind and watch us from above. We hope each soul will find another soul to love. be a prayer, just like every child. Need to find a place, guide us with your grace, give us faith so we'll be saved. Need to find a place, guide us with your grace, give us faith so we'll be saved.
Dan and Amy, bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May Almighty God, with his word of blessing, unite your hearts in the never-ending bond of pure love. May your children bring you happiness, and may your generous love for them be returned to you many times over. May the peace of Christ live always in your hearts and in your home. May you have true friends to stand by you, both in joy and in sorrow. May you be ready and willing to help and comfort all who come to you in need. And may the blessings promised to the compassionate be yours in abundance. May you find happiness and satisfaction in your work. May daily problems never cause you undue anxiety, nor the desire for earthly possessions dominate your lives. But may your heart's first desire be always the good things waiting for you in your life together. May the Lord bless you with many happy years together so that you may enjoy the rewards of a good life. And after you have served him loyally in his kingdom on earth, may he welcome you to his eternal kingdom in heaven. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Well, now that Dan and Amy have given themselves to each other by their solemn vows, before us and before God as witnesses, they've shown their affection and trust by the giving and receiving of rings. I now have the special privilege of pronouncing that they are husband and wife in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And therefore, what God has joined together, I pray that no man or no woman or no job or no money or no house or no boat or anything would ever tear the two of you apart. Dan, you may kiss your bride. You may turn and face everybody. I now have the privilege of announcing to you for the first time, Mr. and Mrs. Daniel Englert.
Hey everybody, thank you for coming. My name is Michael Bobrinskoy. I am Amy's brother. And Dan's brother, come on. We're gonna do the introductions right now of the bridal party. First, both flying in from California, we have Amy's college friend, Lauren Williams, escorted by Nick, I hope I'm pronouncing this right, Bobrinskoy. They're nice enough to keep the flip-flops at home. Next up, we got Amy's high school friend and cross-country co-captain slash star, Lizzie Robbins, escorted by Alex Bobrinskoy, who wanted me to tell the ladies that he's single. Personally asked me that. All right. Next up, we have Jennifer Pearson, who traveled through Europe with Amy. She's escorted by Amy's childhood roommate, William Bobrinskoy. Next up, we have Brandon Newton, Dan's old roommate, who insists on moving in with Amy and Dan. He likes him that much. He's escorting Becky Otten. Becky's from Milwaukee and is a Packers fan, and that's where I'll end that introduction. Next up, Seth Henry, Dan's college friend from the country of Texas. He's escorting Anna Anderson, who's married to that rock star who was shredding the guitar at the church ceremony. Next up, Sarah Engler, a senior in college majoring in geography. She found her way here through Compass. Sarah is escorted by Andrew Russell, Dan's college buddy from Indiana. Let him hear it. Next up, Joel Dixon, Dan's high school friend and fellow banker. If you need any finance advice, go to Joel. He is escorting Dan's sister and new baby mama, Ruth Giuliano. Next up, Amy's most recent roommate and Tulane roommate, Emily Cornegy from the Bayou of Louisiana. Which is convenient, she's escorted by a couple of gators, Greg and Peter Bobrinskoy. Don't think about it, it doesn't make any sense. Now we have our best men, Dan's brothers, David Mark Engler, escorting the maid of honor, Colleen Durham. Show some love. And now, ladies and gentlemen, let me hear it. Mr. and Mrs. Amy and Dan Engler.
A lot of people to thank. And I want to start with the person who is most responsible for all the details of tonight, my bride, Marianne Bobrinskoy. At every stage of this wedding and planning, Marianne took care of all of the planning and the details. I didn't have to do a thing. When I needed a car to get to the church, Marianne had it ordered and it just showed up right on time. When I needed my tux, Marianne ordered it for me. When I needed it in my closet this morning, there it was. And then Marianne actually went and wrote my toast tonight and actually went and taped it out. So Marianne, can I have it, please? Just kidding. Okay, so there are a number of other people that I do want to thank. And obviously we have to start with Dan's parents, Ken and Sue, who did just a spectacular job in raising him. We are so grateful. So grateful for the job you did. And also for the party you threw last night, which we had just a wonderful time last night. So thank you so much for all of that. There are lots of other people, Pastor Steve and Father Hickey, who did a great job at the ceremony tonight. Thank you very much to them. A couple of honored guests. Dan has three of his grandparents here tonight, which is truly extraordinary. Grandma Engler and Grandpa and Grandma Weber-Paul. Thank you both, all three of them, for here tonight. And then lastly, I have to say, I did think Rockefeller Chapel looked absolutely spectacular tonight. I wanted to have the longest aisle that I could in order to walk my Amy down for as long as possible. In fact, originally, I wanted to hold this event at O'Hare on Runway 9 so we could walk for about 2.5 miles. We'd wave at all the planes as they were coming in. But all of my ideas for the wedding got vetoed, including that one. I have a couple of serious things to say about Amy in just a second, but before we get to that, I have a couple of other things I want to say about Amy. Amy was very involved in the planning of this event. Amy spent detailed analysis for everybody involved. She had a two-page agreement that she worked out with the band. She had a two-page agreement with the museum. She had a two-page agreement with the organist at the church. And so I guess I shouldn't have been surprised when she showed up with a two-page agreement for me on this speech, on all of the things I'm not allowed to say tonight. And I was required to write down and sign this contract. But the contract is between Charles K. Bobrinskoy and Amy Elizabeth Bobrinskoy. And as of now, there is no Amy Elizabeth Bobrinskoy. So what I'm going to do is just read a couple of the provisions from the contract. All right, here we go. Paragraph one, the party of the first part, which is me, shall make no reference, I'm not sure where this comes from, to the 2007 Tulane Chi Omega Mardi Gras party? Well, I don't have any idea. Where did that come from? Okay, all right, I don't know. All right, item number two, the famous or infamous Bobrinskoy family food poisoning incident. I am not allowed to in any way imply that that had anything to do with Amy's cooking. All right? And then item number three, the last item in the contract, I am not allowed to say that Amy started planning the details of this party on March 12, 1993. So the contract is null and void. But I do, in all seriousness, want to say a couple things about Amy. I know I'm biased, but I've been to a lot of weddings, and no bride has ever looked more beautiful. You were spectacular. Dan, you're welcome. Amy is not just beautiful. She is extremely intelligent. She is extremely hardworking. She's extremely kind. And she is going to make a wonderful mother of my grandchildren, all right? Now, I don't want to put any pressure, but it did just occur to me, you guys have been legal for an hour and we're not making any progress on this, so I'd like to keep getting started here. What are you still doing here? Okay. But lastly, I will say that Amy, I know, is going to make a wonderful mother to my grandchildren because she was critical in raising her brothers. And when she left to go off to college at Tulane, all hell broke loose. It was not a pleasant sight after that. But actually, the last thing I do want to say is Amy has become... one of the things I admire about her the most is her faith. She has become a devout Christian and somebody who is going to be a wonderful partner with Dan in that Christianity. So, Amy, thank you very much for that. Coming down the home stretch, we are so delighted to have Dan in the family. Dan fits right in with the six Bobrinskoy boys. He has made a couple of mistakes, and one of them was I told him, when you play golf with your boss for the first time, you are supposed to lose. And the same thing applies with your father-in-law, all right? So Dan didn't get that message, and in fact, he's been dominating the fantasy football league in a way that almost called off the wedding, I have to say. But we are delighted to have Dan into the family. I have very little advice, but I have four words of advice that has served me and all of the other Bobrinskoy men through the ages well, is why there has never been a divorce in the Bobrinskoy family history, and that is, happy wife, happy life. And then there's the Jeff Foxworthy corollary, which is, if your wife ain't happy, you ain't happy, all right? So write that down and memorize it. It's served me well in my life. I want to thank everybody for coming. Just one last word. I have dreamed of having my daughter's wedding here on the South Portico at the Museum of Science and Industry since I think Amy was about 3. And the way we had originally envisioned it was going to be an August afternoon, and the sun was going to be shining, and we were going to be out here with the stars on the south. And then Amy told us we were going to do this in November, which threw a little wrench in that plan. But I do want to thank Marianne and all of the people who put this event together in this beautiful tent. And so thank you, Marianne, and thank you to everybody, for everybody who was involved in putting this together tonight. So finally, to wrap up, I get to do the very, very important thing, which is to propose a toast. So everybody raise your glass. Oh, shoot. Before that, one more thing. The most valuable player of the wedding, I almost forgot, was Alex, who got up on the altar and was supposed to do his reading. And then, so just backing up, if you go to our church, when Alex reads all the time, he goes up and there's the gospel or there's the Bible sitting right on the altar with a mark on the page that you're supposed to read from. And then when we did 3 rehearsals of the wedding, Alex went up to the altar and there was the reading right in front of him. Every time, right there, open to 1 Corinthians. So Alex comes up today and he gets up to the altar, and there is a piece of wood with no paper on it. So Alex, quick thinking, turns to Sarah and says, all right, you go first. He Googles on his iPhone 1 Corinthians and reads the prayer from his phone. Alex Babrinska. Outstanding on the fly, the save, absolute save. All right, so with that, now everybody raise their glass for a toast to the future parents of my grandchildren, Dan and Amy Englert. Dan, woo! Thanks, everybody.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. I almost want to say, but that we're going to stand and sing the first 2 verses of "We All Live in a Yellow Submarine." What do you? Doesn't make any sense. But anyways, let me just say a couple things. Isn't this a great, classy family event? And to the Brobinskoys. I got to know Amy. Number of ways. First, she had the wisdom to come to one of my Bible studies a couple of years ago. Very smart girl, you know. But then Marianne and Amy and I were part of a trip to Haiti 2 years ago or 3 years ago, January, I don't remember. And Amy and I had wonderful conversations about faith. And one of the things I really took great joy in today that Charlie just talked about is that Dan and Amy are really people of great faith, and they're very inspiring and challenging to me, and I hope to all of us. So let's just bow our heads and thank God for this night. So Lord, we ask you to first of all bless Dan and Amy as they begin the adventure of their marriage. Keep them close to one another and to you. Bless their families and all of us and our families, and help us to remember the things that really matter in our lives, faith and friends and family. And we're grateful for this opportunity to be together on this submarine or whatever we are. And so we pray together, bless us, O Lord, in these thy gifts, which we are about to receive from thy bounty through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Good evening. For those of you who do not know me, I'm Colleen Durham. Amy and I have known each other since 2nd grade, and we bonded instantly over the fact that our birthdays are a day apart, we love the White Sox, and we only have brothers. She has a few more than me, but nonetheless, we have brothers. When I think of our friendship, Amy, over the years, there are a lot of fond memories we share. But one memory we still talk about to this day is the first time we went to summer camp together. When we arrived, we learned a few things. The bathrooms were 500 yards away from our cabin and had no lights. We would be bathing in the lake every few days, and during each meal, we would be learning appropriate table manners. Now, if you know Amy, you know that she loves the outdoors, so she was on cloud nine. But I, on the other hand, am quite the opposite. So being in the wilderness did not bring out the best in me. The test of our friendship came one afternoon, a few days into camp, when you came back from your horseback riding lesson. You sat down in your trunk, and you asked me to take off your muddy and very smelly boots. I looked at you like, you've got to be kidding me. And your kind and loving response was, Colleen, you've been crying and complaining this whole time to me. The least you can do is take off my muddy and smelly boots. I obviously had no defense and was Amy's boot remover for the rest of camp. Back then, Amy, I helped you with your boots. Today, I'm honored to have helped you with your dress. Amy, you are a kind, loyal friend and the sister I've always wanted. Dan, you are a very lucky man. Let's raise our glasses to Amy and Dan. Here's to a life of love, happiness. Sorry. Love, laughs, and happily ever after.
All right, like you said, we're Dan's brothers. I'm Dave. This is Mark here. We've had the privilege of growing up with Dan, and now we're honored to be in his wedding today. And so thanks for that, bro. As I thought about what to say, I think two things stuck out to me that I've always appreciated about Dan. The first thing that I remember noticing in Dan at a young age was just his really hard work ethic. Whether we were mowing lawns together, growing pumpkins to sell at the grocery store, or helping Grandpa bale straw, Dan always showed me what it looks like to be a hard worker. Secondly, I've observed Dan's uncompromising character and integrity as he deals with different situations in life. Dan has always been committed to doing the right thing, even if nobody was watching, and even if it wasn't the cool thing to do in front of his friends. Dan, you have shown me what it means to be a true man of God, and shown me what that looks like by living it out on a daily basis. It really means a lot to me to have a brother that I can look up to in every aspect of life and learn from. There's no doubt that you have led by example, whether realizing it or not. I feel really lucky to have you as a brother and look forward to continuing to learn from you as you enter this new season of life with Amy.
There's obviously a pretty big gap between me and Dan, and he hasn't always lived at home, but he's always made an effort to hang out with me, you know, whenever he comes home, whether it's, you know, chipping a golf ball around or instilling his infinite wisdom into me. But one of the most notable times is when we were playing baseball, and you know, I made an awesome spin throw, and you didn't catch the ball, and it shattered through Dave's window, and I don't know why you didn't die for it. I'm disappointed. And another thing, I've always had to carry the weight of people constantly telling me that I look like you, and I gotta admit, sometimes it's kind of depressing, but I am serious about the wisdom part. You know, I mean, even in the subtle little things, he's always had a bit of advice for me, whether I realized it at the time or not. So, thanks, bro.
Amy, we're super excited to have you as a sister-in-law. You're truly a woman of God, and just the woman Dan needs. It's been great getting to know you. Your patience, thoughtfulness, and kindness are just the beginning of a long list that make you ideal for Dan. And we're excited to watch you two start your own life. So with that, if you would raise your glasses with me. Here's to Dan and Amy. May they have a happy life together. What God has joined, let nothing sever. May their lives be filled with love and laughter as the two of them live happily ever after.
It's always a good sign when the bride and groom leave when you're going to give your toast. But so we want to say, as I was flying up from the great country of Texas, thank you, Michael, for that. Woo! Hook 'em horns, hook 'em. I was thinking, Amy, on the way up, so I'm Charlie's cousin, so we're on the Charlie side, that you come from an extraordinarily long line of fabulous women. Present company included, that are truly remarkable. And you also come from a family structure that has an amazingly long, happy marriage. So from your parents, Charlie and Mary Ann, to your namesake, Amy Elizabeth, Elizabeth Amy Shaw, my grandmother, to her parents, to your grandparents, and the great-grandparents, as I sat on the plane, I realized that's at least four generations that I know of who are all strong, smart, wonderful women, and they married extraordinarily happily and have provided a wonderful home, a great place for nieces, nephews, cousins, where we all congregate. And as far as I can tell, you've built that with your brothers who can't function without calling you. William can't even go to O'Hare, drive me to O'Hare without calling you to find out which route is the best way to go, which I thought was a really remarkable statement that he interrupted your work day to ask where to go on to get to O'Hare. But I wanted you to know that for all these hundreds of people here with eyes and hearts looking at both of you with loving support, you have twice as many in heaven who are looking at you, including my brother Jim, who would never have missed this party and would love to be dancing with you. And I just want you to know, Dan, which is my father's name, you married a wonderful woman. So you have all opportunity for success in this marriage. So thank you so much from our side.
And I feel that my brother and his wife, Betsy, are all here with us and just enjoying every moment. And then I would like to add a little bit about the influence of Chicago on our family. My grandfather Platt came here from upstate New York and had a very good career as a lawyer. My father, George Bobrinskoy, was welcomed to the University of Chicago, where he taught, and you all may want to go out and take a course in this, he taught Sanskrit. And where but Chicago would they want someone to teach Sanskrit? And we just... This whole family has benefited from Chicago and from all the wonderful women in it and the wonderful men. And I just sense there, I could just imagine Betsy talking about politics and the last election. And I just feel she's here and enjoying every moment.
Thank you.
Watch as the storm blows through and I need you. I gave you all the ups and downs. I gave you for the days of doubt. Oh, but I think I've lost my way. There are no words here left to say. True. divine conspiracy that you, an angel love, somehow would fall for me. You'll always be love's great martyr, and I'll be the flattered fool, and the ups and downs. God gave you for the days of doubt. Oh, when I think I've lost my way, there are no words here left to say. It's true.
Big hand for Chandler, everybody.
Cause you'll always be my baby, and we'll linger on. Time can erase a feeling.
The days come easy and the moments pass slow, and each road leads you where you wanna go. And if you're faced with a choice and you have to choose, I hope you choose the one that means the most to you. And if one door opens to another door closed, I hope you keep on walking till you find the window. If it's cold outside, show the world the warmth of your smile. But more than anything, more than anything, my wish for you is that this life becomes all that you wanted to. Your dreams stay big, your worries stay small. You never need to carry more than you can hold. And while you're out there getting where you're getting to, I hope you know somebody loves you and wants the same thing.
So good. How do we stay so long together when everybody said we never would? And just when I start to think they're right, the love has died. There you go, making my heart beat again, heart beat again, heart beat again. There you go, making me feel like a kid. Won't you do it and do it one time? There you go, pulling me right back in, right back in, right back in. And I know I'm never letting this go. I'm stuck on you. Whoa-oh, whoa-oh, stuck like glue. You and me, baby, we're stuck like glue. Whoa-oh, whoa-oh, stuck like glue. You and me, baby, we're stuck like glue. Won't you do it and do it one time? There you go, pulling me right back in, right back in, right back in. And I know I'm never letting this go. I'm stuck on you. Whoa-oh, whoa-oh, stuck like glue. You and me, baby, we're stuck like glue. Whoa-oh, whoa-oh, stuck like glue. You and me, baby, we're stuck like glue. Whoa-oh, whoa-oh, you almost fell. Too stuck to from the ATL. Whoa-oh, whoa-oh, feeling kinda sick. Just a spoonful of sugar, make it better real quick. I say, whoa-oh, whoa-oh, what you gonna do with that? Whoa-oh, whoa-oh, come on over here with that sugar, sticky, sweet stuff. Come on, give me that stuff. Everybody wants some melodies or get stuck up in your head. Whoa-oh, whoa-oh, 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 stuck like glue. You and me together, say it's all I wanna do. I said, there you go, making my heart beat again, heart beat again, heart beat again. There you go, making me feel like a kid. Won't you do it and do it one time? There you go, pulling me right back in, right back in, right back in. And I know I'm never letting this go. Again, heartbeat again, heartbeat again. There you go, making me feel. You and me, baby, we're stuck like glue.
You're a carousel, you're always unwell, and you light me up when you ring my bell. You're a mystery, you're from outer space, you're every minute of my everyday. And I can't believe that I'm your man, and I get to kiss your baby just because I can. Whatever comes our way, I will see it through, and you know that's what our love can do. I am in this crazy life, and through these crazy times, it's you, you make me sing your every line, your every word, your everything. Everything, you're every song, and I sing along, 'cause you're my everything.